This is just like a person who is using kite, is trying to defend kite and arguing against a supersonic plane, which can travel from UK to US in 2.5 hours. But anyhow, coming from a country of simplicity, I will still like to defend the topic, and I assert that a stent has no role in epiphyseal. But before I start, let me clarify, I am not against interventional nephrology. In fact, I would love to be a proud member of Avatar. I am not against the fact that AV fistula is the lifeline of our patients. In ACPG, I have met several physicians myself. I am not also against the concept that angioplasty may be required at times in difficult fistulas. But of course, when we talk about the stents, a big no to this. Stents, friends, have no role in AV fistula. So let us see at the evolution how this developed. Very shortly after angioplasty in coronary arteries in 1977, people started using angioplasty in AV fistula also. That was in early 80s, and all these observational reports do had some success. Then came the concept of stenting, mainly to increase the coronary patency in 1986, and shortly after, they also tried stents in fistula. But what is the status after 25 years of stents? In coronary, maybe that role is established. Although many people do criticize that they are overusing it. In fact, I have a doctor, cardiologist in my city, about which it is told that if you walk in his clinic, maybe that you are having diarrhea or sinusitis, chances are that you will end up getting a stent inside your heart. And there are also high chances that the patient will get a stent in kidneys too, even if the kidney size is 6 centimeters. But jokes apart, there is no denying the fact that coronary stents have saved so many lives, and it did make life of patients as well as cardiologists very, very comfortable. But when we talk about fistula, in spite of 25 years of standing in market, yet the role is not established. In fact, it has a very bad start. In Johnny Coffer et al., who was the pioneer in fistula, who has started stenting in fistula, all his patients developed re-stenosis very quickly. So right from the beginning, it has a bad start. Then people devised very good. This doctor in 1993 devised a prospective randomized trial involving 58 patients. And out of all the intentions and manipulations, they found no improvement after stenting compared to simple angioplasty. In another study, which was larger than the previous one, done on 87 patients, here again, no difference was noted in secondary patency rates between angioplasty and stent group. Some more bad news to come. In this study, in 37 patients again, there was no improvement in patency after applying a stent as compared to angioplasty, and authors commented that the cost drastically increased up to maybe double the cost of the original angioplasty alone without giving any advantage to that particular fistula. Now talking about cost factor, making fistula is so cheap in our country. In our city, you can get fistula done in 10,000 to 15,000 rupees. But when we talk about interventions, it is 10 to 20 times costlier. In simple terms, the cost of a stent is so much that in my center, I can give dialysis to a patient for entire 1 year within the same cost. And because of all these well-designed prospective randomized studies, it is clear that it's not effective. It's not only ineffective, it is also prone to so many complications. Softening, movement and migration, fracture and infections, all are well reported. Shortly after the placement of uncovered stent, this has to be covered by endothelium. But before that, if infection creeps in, then the entire process may be lost. Not only this, the covered stent, which was talked about Dr. Collins, it takes longer time to get epithelialized, and as a matter of fact, this is more prone to infection. And in literature, way back in 1994, people have even died because of this kind of. So, after 10 years of well-designed studies and case report, the debate was ended by K. Doki when they recommended that a stent do not have a role. They defined how to manage our fistulas. They did advocate angioplasty, But here also they were very cautious. They told ki if this fistula is requiring repeated angioplasties, go for surgery. And stents will be required in very, very occasional people when surgery is contraindicated and when angioplasty is to be made. This is the statement of K. Doki about 10 years back, and that should end the debate. Let us try to understand that why this difference is there in cardiac cases and fistula cases. Look at the anatomy. In heart, we are talking about arteries. Here we are talking about veins. In heart, the anatomy is predictable. There are only limited vessels which are going to be end arteries. You do not have a choice. In hand, you can see the veins. Yes, you can see the veins within, and there are so many veins to choose from. And when we talk about cardiac surgery, it is going to be under GA, a major surgery. This can kill a person. But have you ever heard that somebody died of fistula surgery? At most, he will have a failed fistula. But it's very difficult to understand why. Secondly, in spite of the fact that in heart anatomy is little uniform, still people are blamed of bias and subjectivity. But imagine in hand, no two fistulas are same. So what kind of fistula you are trying to give guidelines upon? And imagine the element of subjectivity in this kind of fistula. Let us compare heart with fistula. As I told, it's easy to operate on superficial vein. There is no need to look through microscope when you read a textbook. No mortality risk in a revised surgery. Cost is definitely cheaper when we look into the other surgery. There are too many options for vein. And another fact to be realized is that in heart, we have to ensure the prevention of re-stenosis by avoiding the causative factor. The patient has to stop smoking. He has to take care of cholesterol. But here when we talk about fistula, the causes which have caused stenosis are much different. There could be iatrogenic bad handling by your technician, or improper care of the fistula, or not timely intervention in first hand. So things are different, and most of these factors which are led to stenosis of fistula may not be modifiable. So in that case, even if you put a stent, this is definitely going to get re-stenosed. And similarly, we should agree that everything which is true in heart may not be true in kidney. For example, obesity, everybody knows, has a very high mortality in heart. But in nephrology, obese people have longer life, longevity in dialysis. So everything can't be extrapolated in nephrology. Coming to re-stenosis, in this one study, they found that even if a stent is patent, stenosis may occur. So definitely things are not easy. But as I told, America is different. They are too much into your fast food. They believe in high efficiency dialysis. They need very high blood flow. They will try to round up dialysis within 2.5 or 3 hours. But most of the Indians do believe in a longer duration, slower dialysis, such as European, which are doing. And everybody knows that longevity of dialysis patients with slower and longer dialysis, which occurs in Europe, is much higher as compared to Americans. Similarly, this was pointed out by K. Doki again, that Americans are putting a lot of grafts, even if they are not properly indicated. They are not going for fistula first. So their patient population is having too much of grafts, and our patient population is having occasional grafts. And in spite of the warning given by K. Doki, as the slide was shown by the previous speaker, we do have some stents increase in over 1998 to 2004. And believe me, all of them were off-label. None of them were recommended by FDA. So, studies did continue over last decade after K. Doki guideline in 2000, mostly because quest for the best, but also because of the driving force, which was the industry and stent. So let us reanalyze the studies which have come up over last 10 years. Over last 10 years, this is a list of, this is another list of 5. To summarize, in all these studies, these were observational studies. There was lack of comparison group. Sample size was small. And it is difficult to apply the result of these studies directly in our patients. But lastly, there was some good news for stent people in 2004 by Vogel et al., who concluded that a different type of stent was safe and effective. But here again, there are too much of limitations in this study. It was retrospective, it was not randomized, it was on graft and fistulas combined, the population was not uniform, the lesion was not uniform, and patient characteristics were not uniform. So again, the result of this study cannot be directed. There was another study which was changing blood flow. This author found no improvement in fistula after standing. So what did he say? He claimed that blood flow improves. Now we have to be very cautious when we change blood flow. How does it matter if your blood flow improves from 400 to 500? You have to just increase the duration of. I will just give you another easy example. This is what I got in my spam message. Enlarge, enlarge, and enlarge. The question is, how big is bigger? Friends, we have to just delete this kind of information. Flow alone should not be changed. Now coming to this FLAIR study, which was quoted by the previous author, this was a good study, multi-centered study about the covered stents. And this was the first study which actually led to the FDA approval of stenting in fistula. But here again, we should remember that the study was not on fistula, it was on venous grafts. Now coming to this study, which has been done on thrombosed AVF, here some patency improvement was claimed by the author. But look at the results. The survival benefit is 85 versus 27 days. Now tell me, after spending 2 lakhs, you gain 2 months more of fistula life. How does it matter? Of course, I believe that in central venous stenosis, it may have some role. There I do not like to debate. But here again, why did central vein obstruction occur? Because of improper use of subclavian vein. So as Dr. Rana mentioned earlier, if you are cautious from the beginning, you will not encounter this kind of problem. So as I told, America is different. They believe in burgers, we believe in biryanis, which take time, but they have more flavor, you know. But as they have stopped using burgers now, and similarly we believe that they will be using less and less number of grafts, and the stents will die. So to summarize the problem with stent, it has lack of efficacy, it has complications, it has very high cost. In India, we have very easy surgery of fistula available, and yet this is not recommended by any nephrology body. Surgery should be the first choice. This is one slide quoting Apollo. They do impressive number of dialysis, they do occasional stents. Similarly, as with Dr. Fuller, they are doing 35,000 dialysis per month, which means 3.5 lakhs of dialysis in last 10 decades, and they have used only 2 stents in last 1 decade. Definitely, this is not practical. I will give you one example of one of my patients. He had a failed fistula. Simple doctor could say that in spite of the fact that he has a failed fistula in elbow, we could still make a fistula in wrist. So a good surgeon can fail. He also agrees that we should be looking for early revised fistula, not for your standing. So when we talk about future, we should also understand that if the life of patient improves from dialysis and you are seeing fistula for 35 or 40 years, but these procedures at the moment, although P is significant, but they are giving you advantage of only 2 or 3 months. So they are definitely not. Future could be a better use of fistula, timely construction of fistula, avoiding central vein stenosis, and so the stent will never be providing a long-term solution. And there is something called fistula first kind of concept in the US, which has started decreasing the usage of PTFE graft. In here India also, we should educate our colleagues for better fistula care. And when we talk about future, it could be more of transplants, maybe a cross blood group barrier, maybe xenotransplant, maybe artificial kidney, but of course, fistula stenting has no role. Coming back to our first slide, after a crash in 2003, the Concorde was actually grounded and it was retired and sent to museum. Kite is still flying. Thank you. First of all, I am really grateful to organizing committee and Dr. D'Souza for inviting me. In spite of the fact he has made me stand in front of Dr. Collins for his master in his subject.